Welcome you all. Once again we are here to discuss about the bending stress, the rest part. As we have earlier discussed about the flexure equation, now the flexure equation has been extended little bit in a different way. That means the same flexure equation, what are the counts or what are the other terminologies which are, or what are the other parameters which are affecting the whole structure or structural parameter. In particular, the bending equation is influenced. We have seen there are 6 different terms is associated with the bending flexure equation. The bending flexure equation, as whenever we are reciting like M by I is equal to sigma by Y is equal to E by R. So, in this particular, as I have, if you recall in my last video, I have talked about, that means in this particular video or in this particular, sorry, topic, we are going to use to find out the bending stress or the due to the nominal or transverse loading, due to the transverse loading, how the bending of the beam occurs and how this bending of the beam and the corresponding stresses are going to occur, we can able to manage or we can able to find it out by using the flexure of the beam equation, and half of that equation is called M by I is equal to sigma by Y. I have applied a load, just I took a beam, I have applied a load on the free end, and due to the application of the load, due to the perpendicular arm, if it is, the load is applied at the tip, so accordingly if the load is applied at the in between some point, then I could able to find out some bending moment, and that corresponding bending moment, although I have applied load, but I converted into bending moment, and due to this bending moment, if there is no shear stress, that means although there is a normal load is applied, or sorry, transverse load is applied, but there is no shear stress is applied, or the shear stress, the intensity of the shear stress is zero, by taking the constant bending moment throughout the cross section, then how the stresses are going to develop and how to represent mathematically, we took the help of the flexure equation of that. Now, in this regard, the other terms like curvature, like its moment of inertia, and I think most of you know about the moment of inertia, how you calculate the moment of inertia and the parallel axis theorem, a bit of that, all these points we are going to discuss in majority, we are talking about that points in this particular video, and they are corresponding 3 major points, and what are the points, I will be discussing the same in the subsequent discussion or in the subsequent video. I slowly I am going to discuss what is the physical meaning or physically how we, when we are saying what is how it moment of inertia, how it affects the design or how it affects the structural configuration. I will talk about all these common factors in this particular video. We know the moment of inertia, section modulus for different section. From this equation, when we calculated, the equation says this M by I is equal to sigma by I, sigma by Y is equal to E by R. Once I know this equation, from this equation I found, I have already discussed about what is M, what is I and what is I by Y, and we wrote one in another form, that means sigma and Y are the varying with each other. So, when it is varying with each other, when I am writing M by I, so sigma can be represented as M by Z, and this Z is talking about the section modulus, and again this Z is equal to I by Y. So, this I is the moment of inertia and Y is the distance of the fiber from the distance of the fiber, means when I am saying this is a beam, and on this beam, if I am taking a cross sectional area, the rectangular cross sectional area, and if I am considering this is the beam and the neutral plane is passing through, the basic neutral plane is passing through the centroidal plane, then I am taking a fiber at a distance of y from the this is the central point, this is the centroidal plane or the neutral plane, and the fiber I am interested to find out the bending or the stresses calculated on this fiber at a distance of y from the centroidal plane. We know about this all a bit, everything we know about that. then what extra we are going to discuss over here. So that is, I am just putting over here like this, in this form I am just putting. So we have already discussed about the beam flexor equation, what we have discussed in the last video. In this particular video we will talk about what is composite beam equation, how to evaluate the composite beam equation, and what is the shear stress calculation. We discussed about there is no shear stress. If the shear stress will be there, then how much the shear stress, and due to shear stress what is happening, we are not going to discuss over here at all. We are not interested about that. We are only interested about to find out the shear stress. If there is a pure bending is there, there is no shear stress, how to calculate, how to evaluate the stresses, we know. Now if due to the bending moment action, if there is a shear stress, then how it will come into the picture, or from where it comes into the picture, and what should be its magnitude of that, and for different cross section how the shear stress varies for that, we will little bit discuss about that. And we know about the shear stresses, already we have discussed about the torsional case. If a structure or a beam or a shaft is under a torsion, then it creates or some shear stress is going to develop. And if it is under bending, that means if I will take a shaft and shaft is rotating, let us say if I am having a shaft is rotating, shaft has its own length, and due to own length and it is under a torsion, then it is going to angle of twist, or every point if I will draw the lines. So every surficial line is under the twisting moment. At the same time it has some length and it is just rest on two support or three support. So the due to its own weight it may bend. So there is a bending stress and there is a torsional shear stress. Then how to evaluate, if there is a combination of the cases, then how to evaluate, we will discuss about a small discussion or a small formula. We are going to evolve a small formula, and that formula how it will be utilized, we will discuss in the discussion of the when we will solve some problems. Now in this context, beam flexor equation I no need to explain again, we have already discussed in the last. And before going to the composite beam equation, we will not go directly the composite beam equation. We will beforehand some of the few points I'll raise. Like we have discussed already, we have discussed, like if I am saying talking about the section, here it has been written as a rectangular section. What is a rectangular section and moment of inertia? As I said earlier, the moment of inertia, how it affects. I just want to show something, like here you can see, I can show you some of the bottles over here. So all these bottles, if you see the characters of the bottles are maybe all are made up of same material, plastic, or some different kind of material might be there. But if you see the looks, all the bottles have different kind of look. It has something, this bottle has something like a rotating type of, it helps you in holding, here also the similar kind. But if I will go to another bottle, it has not like that, it has some different kind of, you can say a different kind of frame, or you can say a different type of aesthetics has been given to that. At the same time, if I will take one more bottle, here also the similar kind, here something rotating kind, here something perpendicular kind of lines are there. So they are not, if I will cut from this half of, if I am making it half, so if I will see from the half side, so I can see the circular kind of, or little bit not tapered circular kind of things you can able to observe. So what does it happen, what does it necessary to discuss about all? So the cross section of the beam, when I am saying this is the cross section of the beam, if I am showing the beam and this is a beam, or this is another beam, and the cross section, if you will see one in one case it is circular, in other case it is rectangular. Instead of that, if I will show the bottles, just now I have discussed them, all these kind of bottles. So these kind of bottles have different kind of shape. All if you'll see, by seeing these two bottle, only if I'll take these two bottle, by seeing these two bottle, or by from physical verification or visually if I'll verify, anybody can say that it is little bit more heavier than this one. And if I'll take in another way, like if you are traveling in the train, if you have taken in a rail near bottle, the rail near bottle which is made up of plastic, and also the kilni bottle, if I'll go. So all the whatever the in our market, in majority the common people or common man utilize a kilni, or you can use, or we are using a Pepsi kilni or Relnir, or like that there are some Bisleri. So all these bottle, if you'll see, the mostly or most lucrative bottle is like a kilni. The low cost, I am talking about the low cost water bottles which are available in the market, ready-made bottles if you are talking about. So the, if you see these structures, what just now you saw from these structures have, although they have all are 1 liter bottle, but they have some variation in the, but you will see the kilni bottle can have little bit more extra strength as compared to others. By seeing that physically as well as by or visual verification, or by if you are using in a long term, they can have a better strength in generally. Why so? If I'll talk about a cello bottle, or if you'll see this bottle, this is also not a very uniform throughout the its length. If I'll take, this is the length of the, or if you are taking about the height, the it is not that the structure is not uniform throughout its height. So all these textures has been made not only the aesthetic part but also to maintain the eye. What I'm interested to talk about, let's say all of you know about the asbestos we use in roof. Asbestos basically looking like a similar kind of, that means a wavy structure, and that wavy structure we utilize, there are some relation or some equations are there. In generally this asbestos I am talking about, instead of this wavy structure, it is little bit more complicated to manufacture. I can make it as a rectangular plate, directly I can make it rectangular plate. What is the extra use by, or what is the extra advantage, instead of that, if I am having a groovy or a half of sine wave, if I will make something in a half of sine wave, then how much or what is the extra thing I am going to get? That basically I am interested to talk about. The moment of inertia, when I say, basically the moment of inertia, what you understand, literally it means, let's say in a cross section, if I am considering a rectangular cross section, or any beam it has rectangular cross section, if I want to find out its moment of inertia, the moment of inertia says, let's say about the xx coordinate, if this is the xx on the base, this is the xx or centroidal axis, about that if I want to find it out, I took a rectangular section or a small section at a delta y, at a distance of y from the centroidal axis, the centroidal axis is the xs if I am talking about, then ixx we are finding out, or whatever what else we got, it is bdq by 12, and it is nothing but the y square bdy, and bdy again, bdy is the area, that means the second moment of area we are getting. What does it mean? The same, this y square dy, that means this is the y, the distance, and once yd, bdy is the, b is the, this is the width of that, and the strip we are talking about, the area is the BDY, the area BDY into Y, first moment of area, and when the first moment of area reaches to 0, we will find that distance, or we are during the discussion of the bending stress or the flexural equation we have discussed, already we have discussed that point, we are kind of finding out the centroidal plane, where the centroidal plane, to find it out we make yda is equal to 0, and from there we got, then to get the moment of inertia we go for y square da. Exactly, or physically it says, that means I am just talking about here whatever BDQ by 12 when I am writing, if you forget about this BDQ by 12, we normally write MK square or MR square. Normally we write MK square or MR square or AK square, like that you might have remembered those terms. This K talks about the basically in generally this K called radius of gyration. What do you mean by gyration? Gyration means whirling speed. If you want to see the whirling speed means any object is rotating, any object or material rotating about its own axis is called whirling about its or spinning about its own axis. If you want to see, you just open your tap if I'm opening a tap on the it is attached to a machine. If I'll open it, the water passes through the when it comes down on the machine, and when it passes through on a rotating motion about its own axis. Likewise, if the distribution, instead of as I said, the asbestos, this A or this R, whatever, what else we name it, as I said earlier, in an asbestos case, if I'll make something wavy in nature, that means the material or the fiber which earlier it was, if it is a rectangular kind, it is like in this form. Instead of that, now it has been changed to the same rectangle or the same beam or rectangular cross section which I have taken. Instead of that, I have taken this rectangular section like this form. That's not it. If I took this form, then the material which was earlier has been taken or was earlier just earlier about whatever the what else the material we are talking about or the material line we are talking about, all this about it distributed throughout. If I take this axis as the my centroidal axis, this is the central axis of the material and this is the central axis of the structure. If I take the central axis below the material, now the distribution of the height of this material point which a fiber line I have taken earlier, now that fiber line has been displaced extra amount. That means I am increasing the k, either I am increasing the k or I am increasing the r or I am increasing the d. What else I am talking about? This BD cube by 12. That means the moment of inertia when I want to increase, either B has to increase or D has to increase. So if I'll increase the B, then no use of the or the amount of increment is not so high if I'll increase the D. That means if I'll increase the height, so it will thrice or three times because it is cube. So the D, it says that means what else the you have the B. If I am increasing the D or the depth will increase, so it is nothing but the depth has been increased here. So if I will increase the depth, so IXS automatically increases. If IXS increases, then what the extra advantage I am going to get? Now M by I is equal to sigma by Y and or M by Z is equal to sigma and Z is equal to I by Y. That means it says directly, if I'll increase the depth of the material or if I'm distributing the material in such a way that, so moment of inertia says, or inertia of those material points are says in this way, if it will at a distance or a higher distance from the centroidal point, then it will have a higher amount of moment of inertia. If it will have a higher moment of inertia, then it will have the material or the structure or the structural component has a higher amount or capability to resist the moment, or it can have a better ability to resist the load or the stress bearing capacity. So, in total, that means as I said, here a cross section we are talking about, you can see in a rectangular section, the rectangular section, all this it is also we have discussed in the assumption, it has been said that about the centroidal point, the material or the corresponding structural form or you can say the geometry is symmetric about the centroidal point. Here also it is symmetric about that. That means the amount of material which is existing above the centroidal point, the same amount of same area of material is existing already over here. So, by this, if I am increasing the D, if I have to increase the D, what I can do? I can decrease the B and I can increase the D, or any other way is there, not without decreasing the B, can I increase? Because if I am increasing the D also, so that means I have to increase, if I am interested to do so, then I have to do some kind of deformation and it has to reduce the B and then only it can able to D. Is there any other form or other processes or steps by to do that? We will discuss about that. So, this is one of the section which talks about how you are calculating BD cube by 12. I think it is already known to you what else you know. I am just discussing about that. I am just only focusing about the moment of inertia now. I think this part is clear. So, I am moving next. So BDUI is the area already we know that. And what the parallaxis theorem says, if I want instead of this, if this is the x-x axis, the central axis, instead of that if I want to find out AB axis over here, so how to find out? I think all of you know. So IXX plus AX square, so I do not want to discuss about much on that. I'll put some point over there. So IAB is the point which is not at the centroidal point, then how to find it out? Now if I know the centroidal about centroidal axis or centroidal plane, how much the moment of inertia plus AX square, A into X is the distance from where it is, this will be the X will be taken care of that. So the similar form, we can also find out some the rectangular section. If I know the IAB, it is a common or general case has been shown. So Z we are calculating BD square by 6. ZX is equal to section modulus. Section modulus is I by Y. If I know the IXX or if I know the IAB, then I can get IAB is any general case from the base if I am talking about. So likewise, I can calculate for the other instead of rectangular section. If I have a hollow rectangular section, then how to calculate the IXS and ZXS, you know. Why we are discussing all this? We will come to that. What is the need of to discuss all this kind of, because we know in generally or invariably the beams or the structural components we use, they have a own geometry, they have their own geometrical shape. So all these shapes have different I. If all these shapes have different I, then all these shapes have different Z. If all these shapes have different Z, then this sigma is equal to M by Z will have different for different material, or sorry, different for different configuration, geometrical configuration. So I has a lot of importance on the geometrical configuration. What else we got for a solid rectangular section? This it not, it may not be same for the same thing is not true for the hollow rectangular section. Now it has been extended for the I section. I think most of you know the I section as well. Here you can see, earlier I was talking at the time of talking or discussing about the rectangular section. I talked about one point, without decreasing B, can I increase the D? Here you can see, the same material, that means earlier which we have taken as a rectangular section, you just see the, it is a just a formation, or you can say transformation of the rectangular section. All this rectangular section, this material has been removed, and instead of this material, it has been created, and this B, although we can also increase the B and increase the D by utilizing these materials over here. That means we do not want, because we know, we earlier during the discussion of the stresses, we know the stresses will be higher at the boundaries only, not at the midpoint. The midpoint it is 0. So there is no need of such high amount of material to consist that, or to take the, or load bearing capacity has to be higher at, or the stress bearing capacity has to be higher at the end boundaries. Either it is compressive type or a tensile type, it should be at the end boundaries, not at the centroidal axis, and the amount of material will be less at the centroidal plane, then it will be better and efficient. Now in this context, the I section is just a modification of the rectangular section, that means removing the material from there and utilize the material in other way, that means increasing the height as well as the increase the base in that way. But the form again to manufacture the same, it is not easy, little bit difficult. So one advantage we are getting in form of the strength bearing capacity, and one disadvantage we are getting in the formation or to manufacture the same. So it is little bit not, I am not saying it cannot be manufactured, then how it is happening. So it is complex as compared to the simple. If it is a rectangular bar or a circular bar, it is very easy to obtain, but in a I section it is little bit more complicated than the other case. So the same thing what else we know earlier, I just to have a continuity, it has been shown all these points, how to calculate I and how to calculate Z. Now the same way the triangular section also, you can calculate the both I as well as both I as well as the Z, and you can have a hollow triangular section also you can have. So all different kind of variation you can have in all different stages or different loading capacity, moment, what else it is going to hold the structural component. Based on that you can decide. Now also it is a more common kind, the circular section we can have, most common kind of section is been used. For the solid shaft we can able to find it out, for the hollow shaft as well. Similarly the hollow shaft also can be found out. I no need to discuss much on that, because all of us we know during the discussion of polar moment of inertia we have calculated at the time of torsion. So basically we talked about four different sections, you see, one is rectangular, hollow rectangular, I triangular, and the last one is circular. Again within the circular, solid and hollow, this four type. Again within this four type, the major four type, the five or six type we are going for, or it is invariably it is utilized in the most of the cases. So what we understand from the discussion, what else we got the I from there, what we understand, and which I have already discussed during the discussion of that. This rectangular cross section says this section is not very efficiently, firstly large area close to neutral axis, as just now I talked about. The majority of the material is just constituted near about the centroidal axis, which not efficiently increasing the I, or efficiently the capability of the material is not going to improve. Similarly, the bending stress is inversely, because we know the bending stress is inversely proportional to the moment of inertia, m by I is equal to sigma by y. So I, if I will be higher, m will be sigma will be higher, the sigma capacity or the capacity of the material or the structure or the structural component will be higher. So based on that it has been written, or based on what else we discussed already, so that only it has been written over here, expressed over here. That means since the bending stress is inversely proportional to moment of inertia, secondly where the bending stresses are low, low area is the same, for example neutral axis. Similarly, the circular cross section also the same thing. It is this is a similar rectangular cross section, and added disadvantage is that as the bending stress increases towards the top and bottom of the area, or the width decreases. So if we know the circular cross section we are talking about, although if I am talking about the IXX or IYY, what else I will take, as I am going on towards the outer fiber, the material is being low and low. So the circular cross sections are not very good enough, or not good in terms of your although the circular cross sections are good enough or good in the torsional part or the shear stress part, but the bending stress they are not good, because the material is going to be tapered. If I take in here, it's a one kind of tapering, or material width has been decreases, so material width has been decreased with the material has been decreases, so there is no such huge amount of matter at the outer fiber, due to which it is low, or it is not a common disadvantage already due to its own geometry. Now similarly square sections are little bit less efficient than the rectangular section. It has again the same kind, because the square section from IXX or IYY, whichever you are going to find it out, in both the cases they will come in the same. And but in case of rectangular section, the part which is higher, that means B and D are, since they are different, so D if it is higher, or B which is higher, so accordingly you can utilize one part or one side, it will be more efficient than the other side, and due to the distribution of the mass. Now the most common or most important, or you can say most efficient, is the I section. It is most efficient as the area, this the I section we talked about. You might have seen this I section has three different section, two flanges and one web. And if you have two flanges, that means what else the material over here, it has been distributed in such a that it will be more on the flanges and the wave, not here. This part has been intentionally has been removed, and that material has been circulated or distributed in such a way that to improve the I. One more section, T section, or you can say L section, C section. Likewise, different sections can be obtained, or again L section, T section. These sections are basically, these are application dependent, where you are going to apply let's say if I need overhead crane has to move. If the overhead crane has to move, overhead crane is moving, it has some wheel, so a wheel path has to be there. If it is moving, so some rail kind of path has to be there, so it has, it needs some guidance also, a guided path. So at that time either C type or L types are preferred. Either C type or L type of beams, or you can say clamp type paths are much more preferred. So that accordingly you can say this C type again is a half of the I section. So they are preferred because of their basic added advantages. So now the similar way the we can also define one term is called, as we know, the load bearing capacity is the sigma. Similarly, or the load bearing capacity or the strength of the material is talking about the sigma. Similarly, the moment carrying capacity is called moment of resistance. That means M by I is equal to sigma by Y, or M by Z is equal to sigma. From there we can also calculate the moment carrying capacity. This is independent of the small length. You must see this moment resistance capability is nothing to do with the bending moment, or bending moment is equal to force into perpendicular distance, is nothing to do with that. It says that it is independent of span and the load, and it is proportioning section, what kind of section you are using. Based on that the moment of resistance depends. Because it is sigma is inversely proportional, the stress is inversely proportional to the I. What else the I, accordingly the moment of resistance will increase or decrease. As I said, the moment, you must ask a question to yourself as well as here it has been said. And some point you may find the question, what is the limit of B by D? How much we can able to make it thin? Because if I am removing the material from the side and I am increasing or utilizing that material to distribute the material in such a way that some are in the flange and the wave, then what should be the maximum one? Afterwards, after some certain length or certain height, the material or the structure or structural geometry is going to be instable. So we know from the very early or initial stage or the understanding, the material has to be stable and equilibrium. Unstable, stable, and neutral equilibrium. You talk neutral stability, stable equilibrium, unstable equilibrium, and neutral equilibrium. You understand that already, and we'll discuss about more in the during the discussion of the buckling. So you just know that if I'm going on making it thin and thin, so there must be some range, or we must have a limit to everything. So there is a limit of the B by D that cannot be go beyond 0.5 to 0.66. So that is the efficient point, or the most optimal point. This B by D ratio will be maintained by 2 by 3 or 1 by 2 in between, not more than that. If it is more than that, then the structure will be unstable. So it may, unstability, due to unstable, you might have seen some unstable structure. Unstable structure, if I take, let's say the electrical poles you have seen on the roads, the electrical poles are standing, most of the electrical, some of the electrical poles you might have seen, instead of standing very straight, they are little bit bent initially. If they have bent initially, that means initial deformation has been introduced, and it creates some instability within the structure. So if you see, this bottle has been already distorted, some kind of instability may create due to that also, and it has not a very good base, and it is very thin and very light. If there is nothing inside this, so it automatically it goes out, blow off when there is some very light amount of air also, it can blow off from that place. So like width to depth ratio should not too small, which instability may arise, as I said. So these are the points or consideration has to be taken care during the fixation. So we will come to the composite. Before coming to the composite, I will quick reviews. What should be the type of section, and what is the moment of inertia, and the section modulus. For rectangular, it is already given. For the rectangular type, we know what is IXX and what is IBB, IAB and what is ZX. Similarly, hollow rectangular and I section as well as the triangular section. These are the four section we talked about. Now, the important notes what we can take from the here the conclusion or what are the discussion we did. Section are to be proportional to resist bending moment, keeping in mind the following. As the bending stress is inversely proportional to moment of inertia of the section are to proportional to give a larger moment of inertia, and I section is more efficient as compared to the rectangular section having same area, because I section has area distribution that gives a larger MI. And we should prefer a material or a structural geometry has a higher moment of inertia than the other one. And while attending the larger MI, the section should not become too thin. Just now I talked about 0.5 to 0.66, otherwise it will be too thin. If it is too thin, also it will create some issues. That means rectangular section MI varies as the cube of the depth section is proportioned to the have larger depth, but the width and depth ratio should not too small, in which case instability due to the accidental eccentricity from the plane of the beam may come. Because we are taking the central plane and neutral plane are coinciding with each other, but in real life situation we may not find, in the most of the cases we find have a eccentricity which creates an issue. And this is already we have discussed what should be the what the limit of the I section, and this is the limit of the I section you must understand. Now, we will directly come to the composite beam. When I am saying composite beam, it comes composite means if two or more materials of same and different phases are combined with each other. Here the same phases of the material are going to combine with each other, but having different kind of property, like where you have can give a composite kind of thing. You see here a plastic part, or you can see here a plastic part has been impinged, or it is inserted. Here also a plastic part has been inserted on the steel. Two different here, although it in a pane, it is already you can say they are in static condition, they are not in dynamic condition. However, you will see to this this is a smaller part. If you see here one part, although it is coming out, it has no such issue. But when these two part is going to fit with each other, and when somebody is writing, including me, when I am writing, I am writing with a little bit higher force, and also the front part, it is under some kind of dynamic loading. There is also one kind of composite beam, or some more dynamic condition or dynamic situation. If I talk about, you can see just. It is assumed that two parts of the different materials are so joined that they act together. You can see just now I have shown these are acting together. If it were not so, each part would act individually and the total strength would be same of the strength of individual parts. Like here a timber, two timber part or two timber section or two timbers are attached with a rod, steel rod. Or you can see, you can understand this, you can take it is as a axle of bull cart. If you will see that cart is made up of, the wheels are made up of wood, the earlier days also, now also you can find the bull cart, the wheels are made up of wood, whereas the axles are made up of steel. One steel is inserted inside the. By also other arrangements are there, but this kind of arrangement you can see the two timber with a steel rod, similar kind of situation you have seen. And the axle has a lower diameter as compared to the diameter of the hub or diameter, what else you can say, the diameter of the wheel of the wooden wheel. The same has been inserted inside the steel rod has been inserted. The steel rod has been inserted on the like this, it has been inserted and fitted with this, some bolt or some kind of pin lock in the front, if you have seen that. Now, to do so, in a composite beam, the behavior governed by the deformation condition, that means the compatibility condition we are talking about, that means total strain is going to be same. What is the total strain, or that is also sometimes called as composite beam or flitched beam. Wooden beams, the flitched beam are named as the when the wooden beam is reinforced, wooden beam is reinforced with the steel plates known as the flitched or composite beam. So, based on the strain compatibility, it has been the whole analysis has been based on. So, what is the strain? Strain is equal to sigma s, we know. in this material, the strain of the steel and the strain of the if I'll write the strain of the steel, so sigma s by es, and the strain of the timber is sigma t by et by reforming or reframing that, the sigma s is equal to es by et into sigma t. Now, in the both the cases, t and s are subscript timber and steel, and they can be written further. This es by et is termed as the modular ratio or m, and we can further write let yt and ys be the distances from the extreme fiber of the timber and steel, because they have different diameter. You just now saw they have different diameter of the timber and different diameter of the steel. So, they have different yt and ys, and they have different maximum bending stresses. And now to evaluate that, as the strain is proportional to the distance, we know epsilon is equal to y, this we have already got this relation. So, we can use that the strain with epsilon s by epsilon t is equal to y s by u y t. Now, doing so, so we can convert into the stress term as well as the strain term, stress. Now, we write the distance and the stress and the Young's modulus in this form. Now, taking this advantage of the earlier discussion of the es by et, now we can represent the equation sigma s m or maximum by sigma t m is equal to es by et into y s by y t. Now, es by et will be m, and if I am writing et by es, it will be 1 by m. You must understand that. So, the moment of inertia m by I is equal to sigma by y can be expressed further further modification. That means, here we are trying to write all this either in t or in m, sorry, either in t or in s. If I want to write or I can write, then one stress can be represented in other form, or that means the timber stress can be represented or steel stress, or the steel stress can be expressed in terms of timber stress with the considering the moment value or moment of resistance. Now, extending the same equation, we got a equivalent moment of inertia, and equivalent moment of inertia is saying it is equal to it plus mis is the equivalent moment of inertia, or in terms of mt, m into sigma t y t, m is equal to sigma by m by I is equal to sigma by y. So, sigma by y into I at the place of I will be replaced by the equivalent moment of inertia, which is it plus mis, or in other way also we can represent by considering the steel also, we can represent sigma s by ys. So, here when it is sigma s by ys, so this is is, when it is sigma t by yt, it is it. So, at that time the modular ratio will be multiplied when I am expressing the bending moment in terms of timber. At that time sigma t yt into it plus mis, if in terms of steel sigma s ys into is into plus mit. So, I think by this way you can express the composite beam. Now, the next part, this centroid, as I just now I have shown here how to find out centroid and centroidal plane, just to have a continuity to understanding, it has been said, otherwise it has no such use over here. The centroid of a figure is that point, the centroid of the figure, when we are calculating the centroid for any figure, I type, T type, L type, S type, at that time you know how to evaluate, only to brush up those things I am talking about here. The centroid of a figure is that point in the figure at which all the area may be assumed to be concentrated. If the figure is subdivided into rectangular areas or and the perpendicular distances of the centroid of the area from to chosen coordinate axis I, x and y. So, y are y 1 and I 2, y 2 the values x 1 and x 2 respectively, thus coordinate of the centroid will give you the of the area of the hole. So, now the parallelasis theorem, we can able to find out the x bar and y bar, the distances we can able to find it out, and this is A is the area and K is the radius of gyration. By this way, the A is the total area of the figure. And what is moment of inertia? Moment of inertia we know already, I have discussed, I need not to discuss again. As I said, I have just continuing the same thing, and how to find out Ix, Iy, and what is how we are representing Ak square or Ak into K again. A into K will give you the first, A into K will give you the first moment centroid, then A into K square will give you the moment of inertia. Now, parallaxis theorem, just to have continuity the same, here it has been represented, and the last part here, this is the part which has, I am showing here, you just see this figure, a beam having a QRST section has been removed and this section has been extended further in the next part by showing the shear stress, how the shear stress distribution and what is the shear stress distribution, the similar kind of figure in the next slide we are talking about, we are going to talk about. Now, in this case, the shear stress and shear stress distribution for various section, if I want to find it out. Now, if I will take whatever the part I have shown just now, the figure from where I am trying to remove, I am not trying to remove, it is automatically due to shear stress. Let us say a part is trying to remove from there and that part is QRST, what else I have shown, this QRST is trying to remove from that material due to shear stress a section of that. You will see from here, that means from the side view, that means this is the area or this is the amount of the fiber is going to worn out from that due to shear, and the left end and right end the values of the F and M and F plus delta F and M plus delta M, which we know various time or different time during the discussion of shear force bending moment diagram. Also here we can utilize the same, and the fiber, the last fiber, this fiber is at a distance of I 0 from the centroidal line or neutral plane. Now, the same thing has been written over here, two sections 1 1 2 2 and that section, let us say the fiber is from the neutral axis is I 0 and the shear forces and the stresses, bending moments are given F plus delta F, M or M plus delta M at the two section, the both end 1 1 and at a distance of delta x. Now, the forces due to the complementary shear stress or stresses on the area QRST tends to slide the block above the area which is resisted by the difference of equilibrium longitudinal forces, and we can write the tau z dx, which is due to the shear stress, is approaching by the bending stress or normal stress, this d sigma da. And how to calculate the d sigma da, before that we know there is a relation between sigma and m and I into y. So, now to extend further, now sigma plus d sigma I can represent, because we know m plus delta m. So, from there we can write sigma plus d sigma m plus delta m into y, and d sigma will be this part, the d delta m will be created due to the d sigma will be inserted in that, or it will come into the picture. Now, this tau z dx can be represented because this m by I is equal to constant, it is going to it in this case the m by I into y. So, if I am putting this m by I, because I am just taking this d sigma part by putting this d sigma part over here, we can write or just sigma is equal to m by I into y, and d sigma like delta m by I, how it is after getting this much by putting this value into tau z dx and integrating over the area, what I am going to get, na, delta m x by del x, it is coming out because it is not changing, or it is a constant bending moment. If I am considering the constant bending moment, it will come out. So, now this area, this z into i is the z is the width and I is the moment of inertia, and y da can give you the delta mx by limit delta x tends to 0, dm by dx will be f. What else I got from here? Now, putting this value, the f is equal to a y bar by f is equal to a y bar, because y da integrate, if I will do that. So, f y bar, because dm by dx limit delta x tends to 0. So, f a y bar by z into i is giving by the I into the area, if I am talking about this z into I, if I will write, then how much I am going to get? Now, this is the shear stress or amount of shear stress develops due to, if it will try to slide from the whole material. In this above relation, if I will write, the z is the actual width where tau is to be calculated, and I is the total moment of inertia about the neutral axis, a y is the moment of the saddle area about the neutral axis. Now, after calculating this for all different sections or different section what we just now calculated for I, similarly we can say the how the shear stress and how the distribution. And we calculated the bending stress. Earlier we have calculated the bending stress. If you have remember, the bending stress is looking like this way earlier. So the neutral axis based on that, if it is sagging or hugging type. But here you can see interestingly, because you just now we have f a y bar by z into I, a square term, or due to the variation of the square, you will get a parabolic form rather than a linear line over here. As in the case of f into a y bar, rectangular section will get, if I will put those values, all this a y bar z and I, if I will put, then I can get the value in total for the rectangular section at the maximum shear stress will be for the rectangular section is 3 by 2 or 1.5 f by bd. f by bd is the average part, so the tau max will be usually f by bd is the known as the mean stress, mean normal stress, or sorry, shear stress, and tau max will be half of the or 1.5 times of the mean. Similarly, the I section also shown in the similar way, similar form, and you can calculate the values, and the values are the maximum shear stress values are shown for all the cases f by 8i into b by d. Now, you can do lot of modification to that, if it is a rectangular, circular, hollow circular, triangular, hollow triangular, likewise you can go on doing, but it here some of the sections and their corresponding values are shown over here, how to calculate and what are the things need to be calculated. Now, similarly in the circular section you see the maximum is the 4 by 3 times of the average shear stress which is going to be developed, and it is going on decreasing, increasing. You have seen for the case of I section it is less, for the case of if I will compare either with the circular or with the rectangular, the I section have a higher value at the numerator, so the stress values are going to decrease. So the combined stress due to, now the last part of this discussion we are coming, combined stresses due to bending and torsion. Combined stresses due to bending and torsion, during the torsion we have discussed, if there is a shear stress, and during the discussion of the spring we have discussed, spring discussion we talked about shear stress and we talked about direct stress. Now here the direct stress might be there at the end point, if I am some support is there, like lathe tailstock, if I am using a tailstock at the end, it is giving some kind of support in the axial, you can have some stress if you know the how to do the operations in the lathe by using tailstock. Now slowly if I will go in case of just now, initially I have given an example, a beam is rotating with some speed, or sorry, a shaft is rotating with some speed, and it is supported at, it is just like a beam, or it is a similar kind of beam, and if it is rotating with some amount of torsion, due to some torsion is applied, as well as due to its own weight it may bend, or some extra disc is attached to that shaft, then due to its own weight or external weight a bending moment will create, and due to the torsion a shear stress will create. That means the outer fiber you will have the maximum bending stress, and the outer fiber will have the maximum shear stress. Now that is the importance to discuss about the combined stresses due to, and there is very practical application for the shaft design, combined bending and torsion cases. This is an obvious situation for all shaft, as I just now said, encountered during the service condition, because both are at the high. The shafts are subjected to not only twisting but also bending moment due to gravity, inertia load, and shear stress due to shear force, usually important as its maximum value occurs at the neutral axis during the bending, and normal stress is zero at that time. But the bending stress and the shear stresses both are higher. For torsion, the shear stress is higher at the outer fiber, and the bending stress at the time of bending, the bending stress is also occurs the highest at the outer fiber. That means two different kind of normal and shear stresses are occurring at the outer fiber. At the same time, the kind of configurations we have discussed, all these configurations have in generally the maximum shear stress occurs at the center, but the the maximum of the or the bending stress is zero. And from our the initial discussion of the stresses at an inclined plane, when we have discussed, we find that tau max or tau is half of the normal stresses. Sigma by 2 tau max is equal to tau is equal to, when we have calculated the principal stresses also, we have calculated tau max is equal to sigma 1 minus sigma 2 by 2. So it is interesting that it is half of that. That means if I am talking about only bending stress will be there, then the shear stress is automatically zero. For what? For isotropic material. It may not be true for a composite beam. It may not be true for different kind of material, because nowadays what else the discussion we are talking about, these discussions are restricted to isotropic material only. But is it true that we are using only isotropic material? No. Then what should be the value and how it should be calculated? Although we are calculating for the case of isotropic case, then to extend that, we must have to have an idea on that. The same thing has been shown over here. The sigma b is the maximum if a shaft is under the torsion as well as the bending due to its own weight. Let us say the bending stress has been shown the maximum and the shear stress has been shown here like this. And the end also some kind of support is there at here. So, a normal stress also develops over here, or you can say a line of load or something like that is there, the normal stress. So, this is all about the bending stress, this is all about the shear stress and this is the normal stress. Then how to evaluate, how to calculate if the combination of the stresses are there? It is a very simple, we know the maximum shear stress value. What is the maximum shear stress value from the torsion? That means tau max is equal to 16 T by pi dq. Similarly, we got the bending stress, what should be the maximum bending stress here? Now, we got sigma by y is equal to m by I or sigma is equal to m by z. And z for that, for the circular, we got how much? If I will put all this value, I can get the maximum bending stress, I can get the maximum shear stress and I can get the principal stress. If there is a normal stress is there or not, accordingly we can frame. So, initially we are framing the rule or the combined stress due to bending and torsion without considering the normal stress effect into that. So, how to evaluate? If it is applied to a torque, we know under a torque tau max is equal to T by J, and the J can be at the extreme point. From there we can write the tau max is equal to T by J into R, and where J is the polar moment of inertia. And we can similarly we can write sigma B max is equal to 32 M by pi dq, 1 is 16 T by pi dq. Now, this both for solid shaft, what else we are talking? We are talking about the solid shaft, solid circular shaft. Now, putting this at sigma b, what I just now already I have discussed in the first line, here also, the shear stress is maximum at the center, which is not important as this magnitude is negligible because sigma b is equal to 0. So, you need not to think about that. But interestingly, in torsion, the maximum shear stress occurs at the end or the outer fiber. And due to bending, the maximum bending stress occurs at the outer fiber. That is the important point. So, the maximum principal stress, how to calculate? Because I have two bending and shear will be there. So, now putting these values, if I have two bending stress, then I can put it here. If I am having one bending stress, that means sigma x, sigma y and tau x y. If I am having only sigma x, then I can put that sigma x and tau x y. By putting this value, I can able to get the values of the all these sigma, the principal stresses sigma 1 and sigma 2. Here, a interesting term we got here, m plus or minus m square plus t square. What is that called? And tau max we know, just now we talked about sigma 1 by sigma 2 by 2. So, 16 t by m plus t square. So, m square plus t square root over. What is this m square plus t square? Now, this is called equivalent torque. One term we got to know, equivalent moment of inertia. One term we got to know, equivalent torque. So, tau max is equal to 16 T by, or you can say tau max is equal to 16 T by pi dq into 16 T by pi dq is the tau max into its equivalent torque. Similarly, the bending stress, the maximum bending stress and the shear stress values, which we have already discussed, it is already there. In this way, we can able to form. Whatever the point we got here, that means three major points we have discussed. If the geometry changes, the I changes, if the or moment of inertia changes, if the moment of inertia changes, then what the other else points are going to change. and the how the shear stress occurs, or the what is the value of shear stress. And two major points we got during the discussion of the composite beam. We got a equivalent bending moment, sorry, equivalent moment of inertia, and during the combined torsion and bending we got a equivalent torque. So by discussing all this, the most of the part of bending stress we have completed. Now the rest part of the equation, that means the flexural equation, will be discussed during the discussion of the slope and deflection. By saying this much, I am completing over here.